We're going to start with a panel on mapping for property rights, which is going to discuss the fact, as Mr. Rabley just mentioned, that many people in developing nations lack property rights. They may go without formal title, they may be subject to illegal land grabbing, they may be subject to encroachments upon their land, deforestation, palm oil plantations, and other illegal usage. As Mr. Rabley noted, these people find it difficult to gather the information that they need to prove that they live on this land and that they have the right to it. UAVs help these people level the proverbial playing field. They make it inexpensive and relatively easy to gather this imagery. That's one of the most revolutionary aspects of UAVs, in my opinion. And with these images, they can make their own georeference and geospatially accurate maps that they can use to defend their rights in court, as has been documented in Indonesia and in other locations. Our panel today brings together Mr. Aldo Watanave from Peru. He works at the Ministry of Culture and has been helping to run their fascinating drone archaeology program. Janine Mera of the Land Alliance has been working on a really interesting project where they're using UAVs to help people engage in participatory mapping in Peru. And finally, Mr. Gregor Maclennan of Digital Democracy has been working with the Wapishana people in Guyana to help them document their traditional lands. They're very large, and help them to document illegal usage of their land. So we'll begin with presentations on their work, and we'd like to begin with Mr. Watanave. I'll be going first. So yeah, please come up. Right. Do we press the? You're gonna present to the podium, okay.
Hi everyone. I want to start this presentation by thanking the organizers, especially Faine Greenwood, for the invitation to present my work. Sorry, I need to read my paper. My mother language is Spanish, so I can't speak English. My name is Aldo Watanave. I am responsible for the application of the drones and the protection of cultural heritage of the Ministry of Culture of my country, Peru. Peru is located in South America, bordering Ecuador, Brazil, Colombia, and Chile. The country is divided by the mountain range of the Cordillera de los Andes, creating three natural regions, the coast, highlands, and the jungle. The Cordillera de los Andes allowed the development of many cultures throughout Peru. During 10,000 years of history, cultures such as Chavín, Moche, Chimú, the Incas, and many others contributed to the development of our magnificent past. But now, there remains this ancient culture disappearing. In Peru, one archaeological site is destroyed by mining companies, natural disaster, construction, agriculture, looters, and others. This was an archaeological site that was destroyed by urban growth. This site in the south of Lima was demolished by the company using a bulldozer in 2013. This year, farmers destroyed a geoglyph in Peru, in Trujillo, north of Lima. As you can see in the image, only a small part remains. This site was destroyed in 2006 by a mining company that was extracting sand. Being an archaeological site in a way, it was impossible to continue it. Once a salvage excavation was complete, it was destroyed. As they say in Peru, you can love what you don't understand. At the end of the 2013, the Ministry of Culture created a special investigation unit. The New Technologies Department, it's an area that uses drones to understand the current condition of archaeological site through photogrammetry. In the field, we collect geodata using a differential GPS to reference the site in question. In the office, we use this information to create 3D models and different maps with ArcGIS to understand the state of the site. With this data, the Ministry of Culture created an online archaeological geographic information system, SIDGA in Spanish. This website is used an online database with information about pre-Hispanic archaeological sites. It includes information such as the location, measurements, and basic information about recorded sites. User can see the location of the Inca Trail in red, archaeological site in orange, and the site where companies had a special permission to build roads and buildings without destroying the remains in yellow. Additionally, users can see images from the drones. In this picture, we can see the satellite image of an archaeological site. Here, we see the same site more closely. And this is the maximum zoom of the satellite image. Finally, we can see the image captured by the drone. With this, users can see the site in excellent quality. Right now, even the Ministry of Culture doesn't know how many sites exist in Peru. In 2013, the Ministry of Culture bought one drone that I flew over for a year. Last year, they bought four octocopters and five quadricopters. With this equipment, we have recorded almost 700 sites in Lima. I think it's a short number, but it's something. To better explanation our work with the drones, I have some example where you can see their application in the protection of archaeological site. The free example is El Huarco. This is a big site close to the beach in Cañete district, south of Lima. We visited this site because the owner of a piece of land next to the site wanted to build a new house. So we flew over the site and created an orthophoto to match the official limit with current topography. Once they overlapped the property and site limits, we saw that the hair property extended into the site and building there called destroyed archaeological remains. Her building request was denied. During further analysis of these images, we found that other homes has crossed to the border of the site. Currently, those people are being sued by the Ministry of Culture for destruction of cultural heritage. Huacoy is located in Caraballo district to the north of Lima. Dates to 15 years before Christ. This year, we received a request to review property lines inside the site. Somehow, the landowners obtained legal titles and sold them to poor people. And their lands create four neighborhoods inside the archaeological site where people build their homes. We overlap the site limits with a map of the house and aerial image obtained with the drones. As you can see here, it will be impossible to move the people. And moreover, the site has already built damage beyond restoration. Nonetheless, we can save the areas to both sites and the principal mound of the site. Now the Ministry of Culture working a new border of the site to be sure that in the future is not destroyed. This site also demonstrates the true power of the drones in the protection of archaeological site. The day we worked of this site, we found city workers building a landfill on the site, as you can see here. This was the first time that we have hard evidence of the destruction of the site, but it was a great surprise to learn that the local city council was responsible. Now, the Ministry of Culture is in court to charge the Caraballo City Council for crimes against cultural heritage. Mina Perdida is located in Pachacamac District, to the south of Lima. The Ministry of Culture received a report that someone was building on part of the site. Our team was sent to take a picture. We found that the person's house did not affect the site, as you can see in the image. It was the result of the dispute between neighbors. However, while we were flying over another part of the site, we saw that a different house invaded the site. Once we overlapped the site limit with the image from the drone, it was very clear that this house invaded of the site. You can see in the image. The Ministry of Culture is in the process to filing a claim to sue the owner of this house. The most infamous destruction of archaeological site was produced paradoxically by Greenpeace. The Nazca lines are located to south of Lima. In this 2012 picture, we can see the famous Hammerberg. Pay attention to the lower left corner of this image. This image was taken by Greenpeace, where you can see their message in large legend. The next day, we took this picture of the white lines and letter C. ¿Cómo funciona? This image will be used in the lawsuit against the organization. So, the new technology like drones are powerful tools in the protection of preservation of cultural heritage. The Ministry of Culture understands the importance of using them in the fight against the destruction of archaeological sites. With a combination of aerial image from the drones and use the GIS, the ministry has identified that many private properties invade the intangible areas of the site. Future invasion can be prevented or penalized with a document of current condition. With this work, the ministry can further approve the completion of necessary construction project near archaeological site by verifying they will not invite archaeological remains. The big obstacle in the protection of cultural heritage, Peru protection of cultural heritage is in that the Ministry of Culture cannot build all place at once. Drones give us the ability to see the condition of more sites in less time. Furthermore, with maps and image made using drones, we can show a new perspective to the public and encourage people to become involved in protection of their sites. We hope that in the future we can stop invasion and destruction. Thank you very much.
I'd like to welcome Janina Mera to discuss her work with Land Alliance.
Good morning. I hope you all forgive the lack of slides, but they are available on the Land Alliance website, so feel free to peruse at your pleasure there. And you'll see me looking down to kind of catch my bearings here. But I am here to present the awesome work that we are doing in Peru as well, in the province of Ayacucho. And this is in conjunction with the Ayacucho government and our partners, Geosystem South America, which is a Peruvian geotechnology firm, and Thomson Reuters. So we have been looking at the problem of the rezagados. So over the last couple of decades, the Peruvian government, funded with a lot of loans with from the IDB, they took a big view of the entire country and systematically titled almost 3 million parcels. Now, of those, 2.1 were actually registered and titled, or 2.1 million were actually registered and titled. But what happened to the other 900,000? So that's kind of the problem that we're looking at, and this is what they call the rezagados. So systematic titling works when you're trying to do big, expansive regions. But when you're trying to look at these little pockets, it doesn't make sense to mobilize these huge teams. So what we're doing is we are uniting the technology of the UAVs, the participatory element of really bringing in the communities from the very, very beginning, and also engaging the government from the start, so that uniting the government, the communities, and technology, we can really bring back legitimacy to the process of titling and everything. If you guys will give me 2 seconds to bring up. Here we go. And so the title for our approach is UAV-based participatory e-formalization. And we have a wonderful flowchart that describes the technology track and the community basis, but I will talk you guys through it here. So the first part of the project really is the project planning, and we collect the existing cartography and the previous parcel and tenure information. We get together with the community for the initial meetings, as well as have sensitization and learning sessions with the communities. And that's really kind of the beginning, to make sure that this is something that it carries on longer than the initial process, is something really getting the communities invested in the process, and really teaching them why it's important for them to have these titles, and continue with renewing and registering, and with each transfer, making sure that that continues. So that's kind of the very beginning. And then after the first couple of days of that, then the community themselves goes out and they mark their parcels. So we are trying a couple of different ways, one of which is marking the corners. Another is using lime to actually outline what their parcels are. And so this is really neat, because they get to physically walk their boundaries. So this helps them, again, one, get invested. Two, it limits disputes, because when you're looking at the neighbor and you say, oh, yeah, I marked that. So when you're looking at it later on, then you can say, okay, yeah, That's what I had agreed to. So then we have the UAVs that go up and they capture all the aerial imagery, and it's very fast. They do the post-processing overnight, and then the next day we come back out to the communities, and the community, well, all the maps and everything that they have done on the corners or on the ground, everything is digitized. So when we bring the communities in together with mediation specialists to kind of look at the map and look at everything that has done, they go through, and the software that we're using is the Thomson Reuters software, which will enable them to put together not just the spatial data, but also the administrative data of who are the owners of the parcels, who's supposed to be registered on this, and collect everything in this nice and neat little packet that then is handed over to the regional government. And it's actually done in conjunction with the regional government. But so we superimpose the old digital boundary, or the old boundaries from the old maps, on top of these newly digitized lines, and take care of any discrepancies that may still exist. Then we, during this working meeting with the communities, really at the end, the whole process, kind of summing it all down, at the end, the regional governments can have this nice, neat little packet of information containing the spatial information, nice orthophotos. When we flew the first planes, the first UAVs in La Libertad and in Ayacucho, We got very, very good accuracy. We had a couple of problems with ground control points in La Libertad, which is the first time we flew it, but then on the second round, we did much, much better, and it had something like 20 centimeters accuracy. So very much, much, perhaps not, well, let's just say that it's a very fit for purpose way of getting all the information out there. And so then the regional governments can use this to go to the registry and get everything ready and titled, and everything to the community is very, very quick. So the entire process takes about, including the community sensitization part and the flying and having the working meeting, the entire process can be done in 10 days. And that's even including, you know, a little bit of leeway for weather or whatnot. So it's very, very fast. Instead of having the satellite images, which one is removed from the community, so it can take years for the procurements, can take forever to get everything flown, and then finally when it comes back to the community, they're just like, oh, well, yeah, things have changed since then. But this is just super fast. 1, 2, 3, we're in, take the pictures, have the community verify, do they agree, do they not agree, get involved in the process, and then out to the government in 10 days. Super fast. So the kind of the highlights of the community track are what I've been saying: transparency, collaboration from the beginning from everybody, and really the process goes beyond just consulting the community. Instead, it gives ownership back to the community of the process of creating not just the maps but their titling and a vision of their village and their community. And one thing that I kind of glossed over is that we also have a forum for mitigating disputes. So instead, some of those rezagados are still stuck in litigation. So this particular way, you have the neighbors sitting down, one next to the other, saying, okay, well, we think this. No, it's this. But then you also have not just those two neighbors, but the rest of the community saying, hey, we know your dad. This was actually the area it was supposed to be. And we know what happened like two generations ago. So this is a nice way to have the community kind of work through their problems without having to get into lawsuit situations in the future. And another good aspect of this is it's also the transfer of technological knowledge and participatory best practices to the local governments. So the community and government working together really bolsters legitimacy, strengthens responsiveness, and encourages good land governance. I know we're supposed to be quite short in these presentations, so I will do my best to cut it a little bit down. But really, the next steps that we're really looking at are continuing coordination with the government of Ayacucho to test and refine the entire approach. Our initial stuff has been quite great, so we'd like to put it all together and really just get it done. The government of Ayacucho is very, very interested in keeping everything going, and they're trying to do their best to get everything organized on the ground and ready. So we'd like to continue testing this approach in Ayacucho, but then also we would like to test it out in a couple other geographic zones. Ayacucho is in the mountainous region. We have tested it in the coastal of La Libertad, and we would really like to test it out in what's called the Ceja de Selva, which is the mixed, like some jungle, some more productive kind of landscapes. So that's kind of the area that we're going to next, and what we're aiming for. So hopefully, please check out the presentation on the Land Alliance website, and if you have any questions, can answer them for you.
Next, we'll be hearing from Gregor Maclennan from Digital Democracy, who will describe his work in Guyana.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming out. My name is, let's get this, can you hear me okay now? My name is Gregor Maclennan. I am Program Director at Digital Democracy. We're a small nonprofit that works with marginalized communities around the world to empower them to use technology to defend their rights. A lot of our work right now is with indigenous peoples living in the Amazon rainforest. These are two Achua community members from northern Peru. You have three Peru-style topics at the beginning of the talk, although I'm also talking about Guyana. This is an area of Peru affected by oil contamination in a project that has been going since the 70s. And we've been looking at how technology can help communities document and report on environmental violations in Peru, in Guyana, in Ecuador. We've been working involving both more traditional technologies like a digital camera, and more recently trying to explore how drones can be a tool, not just as a research organization from the outside coming in, but can this actually be a tool that the communities themselves can use to monitor and document what is happening on their lands? And we started getting involved with getting interested in drones last year, kind of asking questions about how they could be applied to the work we do with different communities. And one question we had was, who's going to fly the drone? There are, I don't want to be the person coming in and flying a drone over somebody's house to gather information, even if it's helping him in the long term, or her in the long term. We're working with communities that are often marginalized and disempowered, and we want the process of working with technology to be something that is empowering for them and reduces that inequality and makes them feel that they're participating more in decisions about what's happening on their land. So our first question was, yeah, can we train people that have never used a drone before, also have never played a computer game before? So the act of learning how to fly a drone is something new. And yeah, we have found that people have learned how to become great pilots, and especially quadricopters are very easy to learn how to use. Planes, the landing, takeoff, it's a really hard thing, especially if you don't have a nicely manicured field to come and land in and take off, and you're trying to land in an area of a forest or even a clearing that may look clear, but then you have scrub all over the place that you have to avoid when you land. But then it's not just being able to pilot this thing. There's this aspect of you're bringing this expensive foreign technology in, which seems magic to people. And that can, whilst the people we're working with are piloting, what about the rest of the village members when this is flying overhead? Who owns this? What is this doing? So when we went down to Guyana last year, I went down with a drone, and the plan was actually to build the drone before I went down there. They were interested in using a fixed wing plane to reach hard to reach areas deep in the forest where gold miners are, informal small scale gold miners are rapidly clearing large areas of forest. And I ran out of time, I was disorganized, and by the time we got to leaving the field, I'd managed to buy all the components and design what we wanted to build, but I hadn't finished it. So I just shoved everything in my bag, took it down there, and turned up in the village with just a bunch of polystyrene and motors and a soldering iron. And we all set to work together trying to build the drone. And I was really surprised at how it turned out. I've worked with communities, indigenous communities in the Amazon before, training about how to use technology and smartphones. It's really hard for people that have never used something like that before to learn the user interface, to learn how to operate a computer. Working with a drone, it's a physical technology. And these are people who are using their hands all the time. And it was great because the skills that they have, like how to put together a hunting camp, or how to fix a motorbike, or how to fix a motor on their boat, could be directly applied to building a drone. And these are also people that are used to dealing with a lack of resources and making do with what they have. So a lot of work with drones, especially DIY drones at this time, means you've got to make stuff up. We had, for example, an air sensor. There was no mounting for the air sensor on the drone. We just had to attach it in some way. So I just said to the team, hey, we've got to put this an inch away from the wing, and it's got to be mounted out the front and away from the airstream. And they searched around, found an old beer crate, which is the right type of plastic. They sawed it down to the little strip. They put a hole through it. They put a Velcro strip through it and attached the air sensor to the front. So one, the people are amazing engineers and are great at thinking out of the box. And two, this was hugely empowering for the community, because then this was not my technology that I was bringing in or the white man's technology from the outside. This was the Wapishan drone. And this is something that everybody in the villages that we went, when we flew the drone, they were like, wow, this is ours. Like, our own people build this. This isn't something we bought from China. We own this and we're flying this. So that was great. So our next question was, how can a drone contribute to local advocacy efforts? Like, how is this actually useful? I mean, it's great, it's cool. What can you actually do with it? We last year took a quadricopter down to Ecuador, really kind of like, let's see what we can do with it. And quadricopters are great as a kind of photography and video tool, I think primarily. And being able to basically get that new perspective on, in particular this case, on land change and forest use. This is an African oil palm plantation in Ecuador. And it kind of, you use it in the same way as a photograph. It's a powerful media hook, but it gives a whole new perspective. Suddenly you can understand just how large these oil palm plantations are and how much area of forest is being destroyed. And this is useful for the outside world, but it's also a really important tool of reflection within a village who had not been outright opposed to these oil palm plantations, but had been concerned about it. When they see how fast these things are expanding, sometimes within their land title, sometimes outside their land title, sometimes in areas which are traditionally theirs but not legally recognized as theirs, it always threw this new perspective out. What's happening in our territory? Now we can see it. We need to do something about it. We need to start discussing these rapid changes and how they're going to affect our lives. Also, when we had this quadricopter down there, we were discussing with the community, and they brought up this land invasion issue they had on the southern border of their territory, that they had what they call colonos, people coming down from the mountains, opening up new farms and areas illegally inside their recognized land title. And they had been fighting for years to try and get the government to do something about this, but it had all been verbal testimony, essentially. People had been going to town and saying, hey, somebody's in our land. So we took the drone down and gathered some imagery and put it together into an interactive map. And this is some aerial imagery from a few years before that we found. And we were able to overlay it with the imagery that we gathered from the drone. I think here we hit upon the limitations of quadricopters. It was a 2 kilometer strip. The batteries only last 15 minutes. We had 3 batteries. We walked out to the end of it. We flew the quadricopter up. We ran in the forest underneath, flew it back down again, and then basically ran for 2 kilometers through tropical rainforest carrying a screen and a controller. But the images really told a whole new and powerful story and really helped visualize how the yellow line is a boundary of the territory. Is it yellow or green? I'm colorblind. Good. and helped show very clearly how this land was being invaded. The other way that we're exploring the usage of drones is in terms of monitoring, not necessarily making maps, but looking at the case of northern Peru and the oil project that's happening there. This is an oil pipeline running through a remote area of rainforest. There are spills along these pipelines every few months, once a year. But it's very hard to access, definitely not by road, and even hard to access by foot. So one idea we're looking to explore is whether we can use a drone as a monitoring tool, a surveillance tool to run the length of the pipelines. And whether this is a remote area where it's not very easy for some drone expert to kind of roll in and do the flight. So the question is, can this be something that the local communities can do and manage and control themselves? This is just an example of, I'm sure many of you have seen drone imagery, but this is an example of some of the possibilities. This is in Guyana. This is a map of a village. It was created from 500 drone images. This was using Pix4D, the free version of their software that allows you to make a video walkthrough. And we showed this to the communities and discussed, well, how could this be useful to you? And one of the first things they came up with was, well, while we can look at our land from this new perspective, this is a great way of opening discussions about land use management. This is a way that we can monitor how our farming areas are expanding or contracting over time, how the forest areas are changing over time, and this can be a basis of land use discussions within our own communities, and it can help hold some people within our own communities to account about what they're doing. So I'm really interested in how this can be not just an external tool, but also an internal tool for discussions. And finally, mining. Mm-hmm. This is an informal gold mining in the Amazon rainforest. It is hugely destructive. Often people living nearby are not even aware of how quickly these mines are expanding and affecting the forest, because there's no reason if you live there to go and visit and hang out in a mine unless you're working there. We've been working with community monitoring programs and community monitors who are going in and documenting where this is happening and taking photographs. There are security issues around that. A drone is a great way of accessing and documenting these sites without having to put somebody there on the ground standing amongst the people working the mine. We were worried maybe that people would see the plane flying overhead, and we quickly realized once we started flying the plane around in Guyana that we're flying at 300 feet in the air, and you can't even make it out if you're looking for it. This is a way of surveying and documenting what is happening. And the images, again, they can serve as an advocacy tool to raise awareness nationally and internationally about what is happening, but they're also a really important tool internally for people to understand how these mines are expanding, how they're affecting them. The local position is not no to mining, but the question is, how much mining is too much? What are the limitations? Where should it happen and where shouldn't it happen? And the images from drones can help people make that decision. The final question was processing and using the information. Like, can this be something also that the communities themselves can do? Are they going to rely on experts from the outside doing it? And that's important. We're not just looking at empowerment in technology, we're looking at empowerment in information and control of information and how the communities can leverage that information for their own needs and decide how it is used and how it is published. The interactive map I showed you of Ecuador, of the land invasion, it's cool to look at if you have access to internet, if you're in the community or you're in a meeting with a local government official where there's rarely a PowerPoint or an internet connection, you need stuff to be printed out. So we need to be thinking through workflows that include printed maps and paper, because that's how you can have a discussion around a paper map. It's very hard to have an open discussion around a laptop screen. And this was a kind of highlight the sort of limitations of drones. The areas we're working in normally with traditional communities that have communal land titles rather than individual land titles. They're not, their land use and their land rights are not based on their farm use, but they're based on traditional land use. And this is what you see. This is actually a satellite image. It's a digital globe area, one of the few areas in the Amazon where you have high resolution imagery. But if you had a drone, you wouldn't see anything more than more details of the trees. A drone could reinforce the idea that this is an empty area. And doing the work with community mapping in an area like this helps show the network of streams, which is underneath the canopy, the network of hunting paths, the different types of plants and their different use for medicinal use, for fruits, for use for house building, the hunting camps. All of these things are not things you can see from the air, no matter how detailed resolution you get. So I think it's important to bear in mind that drones can be a powerful tool, but they don't necessarily tell the whole story when we're talking about land rights or land usage. And this was just quickly to talk about the technology and the software tools around this. This is moving fast all the time. Some people might be familiar with some of the open source software for setting up a mission. This is a screen that you can bring up if you want to georeference the images that come back from a drone. This is not very easy to teach somebody how to use. There's one button in the middle here that says GeoRef Images, and there's a bunch of buttons that you can press and can mess a lot of things up. And this is a screen for georeferencing images. It's fantastic that these tools exist, and so many new features are always been added that allow us to do so much. But the sort of next step, I think, is trying to make these easier and more accessible. There's been some great work on the mobile apps being able to do that. At the moment, they only work for quadricopters and not for planes. Some of the commercial apps are making things easier. How can the open source world move towards making the technology around planning drone missions and processing information from drones more accessible and easier to use? So summarizing, the uses, it gives us a new perspective. It can help raise media awareness of an issue. They can be used for mapping and land use. They can monitor hard to reach places. And the challenges, local ownership and maintenance, the complications of the technology and the software around it, and how we can, the time it takes to train somebody. Takeoff and landing, it's really hard when you're flying a plane. Quadricopters don't fly that far in vast areas of rainforest. Processing images, you need an electricity supply that's going to run for 24, 36 hours without breaking off, which is hard in a lot of places. And thinking about how to make this imagery useful for at a local level, at a local advocacy and regional advocacy level, as well as an international communications level. And how we can tell the full story. Drones are one tool that can help tell this story, but it's important to also bear in mind the other storytelling tools and the research tools that we have available that can complement this information to tell a bigger story of land rights and land use change. Thank you very much.
Now I'd like to invite all our panelists to the stage for our questions. I'll ask a few questions, and then we'll take questions from the audience. Okay, well, thank you for joining us today. We really appreciated the conversation so far. I'd like to ask a couple questions of you all, and then I'll open it to the audience. My first question would be, what was the most challenging aspect of using UAVs in your field work? Yeah. Aldo?
I can respond in Spanish, and you can translate, please.
All right, I'll be
translating. Yeah, that'd be fine.
I'll try.
Yeah.
Bueno, la parte más difícil de trabajar con eso es tratar de convencer a la población que está dentro del sitios arqueológicos.
Trying to convince the population within this archaeological site.
Que nos permitan a trabajar y demostrar que con esto no es quitar los terrenos a los propietarios, sino ayudarles a buscar la solución entre el preservar nuestro pasado y preservar sus casas.
So it's looking at how we can work with the people living within these archaeological sites to convince them that we're not just looking to take away their lands, but we're looking to work with them to how we can balance the preservation of our archaeological history with the current needs.
Fantastic, thank you, Aldo. And you next.
The technology seems very new, and it's hard to find information about it which is accessible to somebody that doesn't already know a lot about drones. And just what you've written in the book right now really kind of breaks down a lot of stuff that if I had 2 years ago would have made everything a lot simpler. There's a whole load of information in page 100 of some online forum, which is really useful, but hard to find. And the technology is fantastic, but it's still, a lot of it's the kind of hobbyist technology. The commercial side of things, there's a lot of work to be done to make it simpler and more accessible, but the price makes it inaccessible. So more and more we're seeing more commercial focused drones, which are easier to learn and easier to use. So that I think that barrier is dropping all the time, but it's been a challenge.
And now what has been the issues for you at Land Alliance?
Surprisingly, one of the issues that we have faced is a little bit of resistance from the regional governments. From the technical folks that are on the ground, and sort of like this fear that the UAV technology is going to replace what they do on the ground. And so part of the challenge is to get them to understand that this isn't replacing what they do, because they are crucial in this entire process, because the UAVs, they take pretty pictures, but they still need people to analyze and interpret those pictures and those images and contextualize the orthophotos in a way that people can use them. So that has been a challenge, and it has actually been quite rewarding to be able to see the people kind of go through that process and really understand and be like, oh yeah, we really want to do this. This is perfect. So.
And my second question would be, what have you found to be the most effective way to engage local people in what you're doing? How have you found ways to engage people and help them participate in the process?
¿Cómo hemos encontrado la forma más efectiva de buscar la participación de la comunidad en el proceso de trabajo con los UAVs?
Bueno, es muy difícil. Hasta ahora no hemos encontrado un camino para la solución entre invasores o propietarios dentro de sitios arqueológicos.
So it's a very difficult problem. We haven't yet found a good solution of dealing with the situation of invaders into archaeological sites.
Aún estamos tratando de convencer a estas personas que debemos proteger el pasado para conocer un poco.
So we're still struggling to convince convince people that we must preserve the past, that this is important. Building a drone with the local community, and that resulting in the sense that this is something that they're doing and it's not somebody from the outside that's monitoring them, was really important for the participation. And people are wanting to do the same things you might do if you're coming from the outside with an environmental perspective. You know, they have the same questions about how to manage land use and manage land use change. And if they're not feeling that somebody else is coming in and monitoring them, they're much more open to kind of discussing that and using this technology and kind of really kind of involving everybody in that discussion locally.
Involving the community is kind of the main part of our approach. The way that we have found a way to do this and really involve all of the community, many times when community participation elements are brought into a project, women stay home, take care of the kids, they don't really get involved in the process. So one of the ways that we are really trying to involve all of the community, including women and youth, is we are providing daycare for the kids so the women can come. The government of Ayacucho is providing food for the entire community, so therefore women don't have to like leave in the middle to go and make dinner for the men that are at the presentation or at these interactive meetings. And really, that's something that's also very important to point out. During the
sensitizing or sensitization sessions, it's not us preaching to the community, but rather it's really this give and take, this interactive, really asking the community what they think about the titling and what their uses would be, and really having this dialogue with the community where they feel a little bit more of ownership in the process.
Fantastic. Now we'd like to take some audience questions. Yes?
my question starts with digital democracy.
Yeah, there's a mic.
My question starts with digital democracy, but sort of extends for everyone. What kind of government permission did you get? And, you know, more broadly, in cases where the government may be actually the problem, which didn't sound like the case so much in Peru, but how do you think about if the government is the encroacher and may not want information to be disseminated about what it's doing, how do you handle that?
In the two countries where we've experimented with drones in the community, in Ecuador and Guyana, haven't been able to find any clear information about permissions and whether they're needed or what that involves. It's come up with customs officials coming into the country, and their response has kind of been, I don't really know, go ahead. So there's a big lack of clarity, and it's really important that as this moves forward and issues around using this for community activism move forward to get clarity and understand the risks. You know, is this work that's going to be easy to continue? There's very few clear legal frameworks or information about what to do, and I think this is very new for a lot of countries, and they haven't really got something in place. So.
Anyone else, or can move on? Yes, sir.
Hi. Hello. I was intrigued by the comment that the canopy prevents you from seeing a lot of the patterns of behavior, et cetera, underneath. Have you thought about any expansion of thermal mapping and thermal imaging together with this imaging, and how many layers could you add to, in a sense, create a more realistic profile of what might be occurring below the canopy?
Yes, and land use and land rights, particularly in the context of indigenous people, come from traditional or historical land use. So we may be talking about an area that is important because of its historical context or its spiritual importance to the community. Having said that, there is, for example, using infrared imagery to analyze different forest types. A lot of what you're seeing in that drone map I put there was the identification of different fruiting trees which can attract animals. And people know down to a certain level, like in this area, there are this cluster of fruiting trees that are going to attract tortoises in May. And then we can all have tortoise soup because that's where they're going to be. And using infrared imagery on a drone can help pick out those different types of trees. I'm really excited by those possibilities because it's further evidence of what people are saying. All of this is like people are saying this, and the imagery can gather that kind of backs them up. It adds more power to their argument that I know this territory and it belongs to me, and we should have our rights recognized to this area.
Fantastic. Anybody else? Or? Yeah, would you like to?
So one of the things that we're thinking about for exactly those mixed cover kind of situations or full cover is trying to really see how the use of maybe LIDAR mounted on the planes could really help us look down and at the floor a little bit better. But that's still kind of in the process of being developed, not really ready to roll out yet.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
I'm Tara Oh from Pacific Forum CSIS. I normally do national security, so this is a different field. But first of all, thank you for your presentation. Greg, you mentioned that access to information is very empowering, and that's something that we'd like to promote. Has anyone thought of using the drones to provide internet service to remote locations. I know you talked about the problem of the battery, but has that been a consideration?
I've thought about it, but I have no idea how to do it. But internet access is hugely important because most of these areas don't have any internet access. In the Amazon, there's no cables running in, so satellite internet is your only option, and it's cost prohibitive and very slow. And in terms of accessing imagery over the internet or sending drone photographs up to be processed in the cloud, it's impossible and seems far away for many places, even from jungle cities like Iquitos, for example, in Peru, where I lived for a while. It's 400,000 people in the city, but the internet is still really slow and not really feasible to do good cloud processing or anything. So if somebody figures out a way to provide internet via drones, fantastic. But and if we can access something other than just Facebook through it, that would be great.
Anybody else on that? Okay, next question. Yes, Anthony.
Tony Cordero, Spatial Networks. So I guess the question I would have is, listening to the presentation, is so what? So what's next? So, you know, whether you're monitoring illegal logging, gold mining, encroachment on archaeological sites, how is what you're achieving with the drones being used to try to understand why people are doing what it is that you're observing, whether it's illegal logging or, you know, tapping an oil pipeline and causing a leak, or, you know, what comes next now that you've kind of done this initial research?
Now, the problem is in Peru is, I don't know it's the problem, but we have a lot of archaeological sites. I think the last year, the ministry has, we have 100,000 archaeological sites in Peru. So the city always grows. I think the next, the Ministry of Culture need be more, necesita estar un poco más en los sitios.
It needs to be more present on the ground.
For protection on the archaeological site. When the people destroy the archaeological site because the Ministry of Culture doesn't exist. When the people see that the drones from the Ministry of Culture in one side, on all the sides, va a pensar que existen, ahora sí existen.
When they see the drones, then they're going to understand that this really exists, that something is there. It's going to engage people. It's a really good question. And I think one, the mapping with drones can help strengthen legal processes to get land rights recognized. I haven't done much. You've probably done far more in like how that can be used. The power just of the media tool, whether or not it is a legal issue of land rights, but just understanding violations of environmental code, of oil spills or dumping into a river, and having that imagery that can act, one, in the press of calling and leveraging media attention against something, or second, within a kind of administrative process with something at the equivalent of the EPA of kind of going there and having something to show that helps support what you're saying. And third, the land use management, the discussions that it's starting to open up within the communities. We really believe that local communities are the most important partners to sustainably manage forests and resources, and the imagery provided by drones can provide the information that can motivate those discussions and help guide those discussions that people are having locally to make land management discussions. So, but I think there's a lot of kind of new examples, but I don't think we've got enough evidence to kind of say, yeah, this is great. This is like, there is one of many tools that we have, and it's a great new one. But we need to keep on experimenting and seeing what works and what doesn't.
And I see our project as something as preventing the illegal mining and logging and all of that, because really secure property rights are the bedrock for community development. And so in being able to go through and help these communities and these individuals within the communities title their land and create that security, they will be able to protect their land, they will be able to, they have more incentive to invest in their land, and all of that kind of leads to this rural development where therefore they will be able to not only protect their land from encroachers, but also they themselves will have a reason to work on their own land and not also be encroaching on other territory or other logging or anything like that. So it's kind of not the retroactive, okay, we need to take care of this. It's the looking forward, proactive, this is a way to move forward kind of solution.
All right, one more question. Anybody? Yes.
I'm wondering if you've seen any reaction from the people that you have been monitoring. Sort of a thought I've been playing around with is that launching a drone is a provocative act, and the industries and the people that you're talking about have a financial interest in what they're doing. Have they started paying attention to what you're doing? Have they started changing the way that they're behaving to try to hide more? Are you worried that these moneyed interests will go to the government and get you shut down? I guess that's what I'm wondering is, have you noticed a reaction and are you worried about that?
And what's your name?
My name is Matt Wade. I'm with the University of Nebraska.
Thank you.
¿Qué es lo que dijo? Igual, ¿estás preocupado que el gobierno se va a cerrar el trabajo, el proyecto porque hay otros intereses económicos?
Yes. Before last month, the Ministry of Transportation and Communication Bureau create a new regulation, the drones, to say, oh, if you paid for, you paid someone for fly the drones or work with the drones, it's illegal. Now, if this is, a very hard for us because now our work is illegal. It's incredible. Create a specific restriction to say you can use the drone for protect the archaeological site. Use the drones for forests and puntos específicos para sacar a todos de la protección de los de todo el medio ambiente en Perú. Specific points, create a specific form for restriction. Many persons in Peru think that it's not restriction for protection their privacy or properties the people, sino es crear para de negocios que ellos tienen dentro del país.
So they instead thinking about it for business it can generate within the country.
Now we work in destruir esa nueva restricción. Destruir esta nueva destrucción.
Destroying this new destruction?
No, then this regulation.
So oh, we're working to try and take down this new regulation. It's a risk. There are different directions it could go. You know, and there are ways that you could remove this empowerment. You know, a country could easily pass legislation that says only a licensed drone operator can fly, and then suddenly you're stuck with the situation of the outsider coming in flying, and that changes people's reactions on the ground. If they feel somebody's monitoring them, it's not received very well. If people are controlling it themselves, then they're more likely to open it. But I think there is a reaction. You know, when we first kind of started playing around and testing, we were working with a few members from a community and on the riverbank, and they were learning how to fly, and they flew it up along the river to the next house. And the first reaction of the next house, who didn't know about it, was like, hey, what's that drone doing? And then they found it was their neighbors, and it was people from their community flying, and they were cool with it. But we realized that, yeah, you can't just fly a drone over somebody without their consent, without speaking to them about it first. So that's important.
And we, since we're not going over contentious sites such as the illegal mining or logging or whatever, what we have gotten is curiosity by neighboring communities where they'll fly the UAV, and then people from next door, well, not even next door, but the neighboring community over that sees this little plane flying will come over and be like, hey, what's going on? We actually, in Ayacucho, during the last round, there was a bus of people that came over to see what was happening. So it's mainly curiosity.
All right, well, thank you guys so much, and I think we'll move on to our next panel. Thank you.